Can we use dynamical system analysis to get some interesting insight on election opinion polls? With the election in a few days, we are constantly bombarded with the results of the latest opinion polls, trying to measure the support of each candidate or option. But to what extent can we trust opinion polls? This is a reasonable question, especially considering past elections where opinion polling predictions didn't quite match the final result. For instance, thinking back to 2016, almost every major opinion poll suggested Hillary Clinton would win. Or to the Brexit referendum in the United Kingdom, where opinion polls were predicting a victory for Remain that didn't materialize. And this is not just a phenomenon that manifested only in 2016. Similar disappointment reappeared also in the 2020 US presidential election. Maybe you think that polls are rubbish, or maybe you are one that follows the polls religiously. But I want to give you a different, somewhat original perspective on whether opinion polls are reliable or not. I think that it would be a fun exercise to use dynamical systems to try to answer this question, providing an original point of view and at the same time helping us to see exactly how to interpret opinion polls. This is Dr. Giordano Scarciotti. I'm an academic at Imperial College London working on control engineering and modeling. Today I want to create, together with you, a mathematical model that replicates the process of polling. To construct this model, I will use the lessons learned from the 2016 US presidential election and the Brexit referendum. I will start with a very simple model and I will add layers a bit at a time to explain how uncertainty affects the results of the polls. I will then conclude the video talking about the validity of a single poll, the validity of aggregated polls, and the way the news reports this information. So let's start. We're going to construct a dynamical system. So what is a dynamical system? A dynamical system is a mathematical model used to describe how quantities evolve over time based on a set of rules or equations. Now think a moment about this. Almost everything in the universe evolves over time. This means that dynamical systems are an extremely powerful mathematical modeling framework that can represent an incredible amount of processes. Dynamical systems are widely used in physics, biology, economics, engineering, and many other fields to model time-dependent behaviors. So how do we go about creating a meaningful dynamical system from opinion polls? First of all, we ask ourselves, what is the objective of opinion polls? The objective of polling is to discover the underlying real approval rate of a candidate or option. So first of all, let's model such underlying real approval rate. For the purpose of this video, we can assume that candidate A has an approval rate that over the last 30 days follows this curve. It oscillates up and down around about 50%. The oscillation is caused by interviews, news, and actions that may change the opinion of parts of the population. The last point in the graph on the right hand side is the election day when the real approval rate is finally measured. Now, please keep in mind that this curve that you see here is actually unknown. It exists but is unknown unless we hold a full election every day. The problem pollsters are trying to solve is to find out this real approval rate at some point before the election. This can actually be interpreted as a control engineering problem. In fact, this problem consists in trying to reconstruct some hidden variable, the real approval rate, from some measured quantities, the surveys carried out by pollsters. This is called an observer design problem. However, polling can also be seen in a slightly different way as a different control problem, namely a tracking problem. In tracking, we have a quantity that evolves with time that we want to track, in this case the real approval rate, by controlling another quantity, in this case the poll result. Even though the tracking problem is a less accurate description of what's going on, because there is really no control here, it is easier to explain and is enough to analyze the process of polling. So, to simplify the mathematical explanation for this video, I will use tracking even though it's a less precise formulation of the problem. Let's introduce some variables. By xr of t, we indicate the real approval rate of candidate or option A as a function of time. For instance, xr of 22 October indicates the approval rate on the 22nd of October that in this graph is about 52%. This information is unknown to the pollster. Then by x of t, we indicate the estimated approval rate by a pollster. Obviously, the pollster wants to achieve the objective that x of t is equal to xr of t, meaning that they want that x of t tracks xr of t. So how do we model this? The simplest model that we can construct is the following. Dx over dt equal to minus m times x of t minus xr of t. What does this mean? Dx over dt indicates the derivative of x. The derivative of x can be understood as how x changes. If the derivative is positive, then x will grow. If the derivative is negative, then x will decrease. If the derivative is zero, then x will stay constant. On the other side of the equal, we have minus m times x minus xr, where m is a positive number that I will explain in a moment. Let's make a plot where we have dx over dt versus minus m x minus xr. We place the origin of this plot at xr, meaning that the origin of the plot is the real approval rate. If we do so, we see that if x of t is greater than xr of t, then the right-hand side of the equal is negative because of the minus sign. When a derivative is negative, this indicates that the quantity will decrease. Thus, if x is greater than xr, x will decrease towards xr. Vice versa, if x is less than xr, then the derivative is positive and x will increase towards xr. The result is that this simple dynamical system behaves so that x will always go towards xr. Now remember that xr is not constant, so actually x will never catch up with xr. We can make x approach xr faster by making m larger, but there will always be a delay. This has to do with some interesting deep mathematical property of control systems called the internal model principle, which is beyond the scope of this video, but it is worth mentioning. In any case, this delay is useful to us because it models the idea that the pollster always lag behind the actual real approval rate by polling, for instance, the population on the 20 to 22nd of October and releasing the result on the 24th of October. If we plot the x resulting from this dynamical system, we get this. You can see that x of t follows xr of t quite closely. You can imagine that the parameter m represents how good a pollster is. I call this parameter the pollster magic number, which is why I indicated this by the letter m for magic. The better method the pollster uses, the bigger the m and the closer you get to the real approval rate. Unfortunately, things are much more complicated than this. Pollsters have no way of actually measuring xr of t, because they cannot interview the entire population. Pollsters have only access to a sample of the population. This means that they are not tracking xr of t, the real approval rate of the entire population, but they are tracking a new variable, which I call xs of t, which is the approval rate of the sample they are using. Let's try to model this xs of t. Xs of t is affected by numerous biases. First, there is sampling bias. Pollsters try to represent the entire voting population, but they rely on a sample, a smaller group selected to represent the whole. If you are polling for an election, you need to talk to both city and countryside voters, young and old, highly educated and less educated. But if you don't balance that sample well, you may not capture certain groups accurately. That's called the sampling bias. We indicate sampling bias with a function called the bsampling of x, xr, t. We don't know what this function is, and generally we assume that it may depend on both x, xr, and also time. We will come back to this later, but let's move on for now. Second, we have response bias. Some people don't answer polls, and response rates are lower than ever. If certain groups are less likely to answer, pollsters may miss their views entirely. We indicate response bias with a function called the bresponse of x, xr, t. Again, we don't know this function. Then there is social desirability bias. Sometimes people may not fully disclose their preferences. This could happen if they feel that their views may be judged. We indicate social desirability bias with a function called be shy of x, xr, t. Then there is last minute swing voters. Many voters didn't make up their minds until the final days, and a large number of them in 2016 broke for Trump. Polling data didn't capture these last minute shifts, which are usually indicated as undecided in the opinion poll results. This leads to discrepancies between the polling predictions and the election results. we indicate last-minute swing voters' bias with a function called belate of XXRT. Then there is bad faith bias, the fact that pollsters may have hidden intentions in promoting or not a candidate. This may be the case because it's known that the result of a poll may influence the population. For instance, if you want to vote for candidate A and candidate A has a very high approval rate, you may decide not to go to vote and do something else because you think that the candidate is going to win. Generally, bad faith biases cancel each other, so I will not model them here. Finally, there is turnout bias. Specifically for Brexit referendum, one of the biggest factors was turnout. Pollsters did not accurately estimate the proportion of younger people who would turn out with respect to older generations. Even though younger votes supported Remain in greater proportions, for various reasons such as students who moved to a different city to attend university without updating their voting address, the turnout of younger voters was less than expected. Older voters instead would lean towards Leave turned out in higher numbers, shifting the results in favor of Brexit. So pollsters expect turnout rates that didn't align with reality. We indicate turnout bias with a function called bTurnout of XXRT. How can we integrate all these quantities? One way to do so is to model XS as XS of T equal to XR of T plus bSampling plus bResponse plus bShy plus bLate plus bTurnout, and if you want, plus bitbadfaith, even though it doesn't change anything. Each function then needs to be modeled as well. This becomes quite complicated, and for the purpose of this video, it is not really necessary. We can make the simplifying assumption of using the simplest possible model for the bias functions by just considering constants. So assuming, for instance, that bSampling XXRT is always equal to capital bSampling, where capital bSampling is just a number. This is not a particularly precise model, but it simplifies our life, and it is enough for us to see that pollsters are not estimating XR, but are biased approval rate XS given by the contributions of all these weights. Now, when a pollster conducts a survey to create an opinion poll result, they will try to minimize these biases as much as possible by trying to select a good sample and trying to make corrections to counteract these biases. However, all these actions are effectively arbitrary. There is, of course, experience and methods behind these actions, but every pollster will apply their secret recipe. What is the result? If we now simulate the new equation with a random selection of bias weights, we obtain the following graph. You can see now that in this particular simulation, X is quite different than XR. Note also that the pollsters do not produce results continuously in time, so for better illustrate the result, I have highlighted two points in time in which these particular pollsters performed a survey and released the results. If I make a new simulation with another selection of the bias factors, you see that now the result is completely different. While the previous pollster was underestimating the real approval rate, the second pollster is overestimating the real approval rate. We now run the simulation 10 times, each time with different values of the biases to indicate the differences between the samples used by 10 different pollsters and the different methods used by 10 different pollsters. The result is illustrated here, and again I indicate the poll results with a black dot, as pollsters conduct polls only at specific dates, not continuously. Moreover, let's now compute the average of all these pollsters and see what the average result is. This is indicated in the graph by the dashed red line. It is not quite the same as the real approval rate, but is close, and the more pollsters I simulate, the closer the average will get to the real approval rate. I want to stress already now that looking at the average is problematic, and I will explain why later in the video. This plot is actually remarkably similar to real opinion poll results. For instance, if we look at the Wikipedia regression model obtained by weighing a large number of opinion polls results for the 2024 US presidential election, we see that the curve in Wikipedia and the one obtained using a dynamical system approach are similar. Let me clarify that, mathematically, this does not prove anything. But for illustration purposes, this is good enough. So what are the conclusions? First, a single poll is affected by many biases, and no matter what the pollster does to mitigate these biases, the poll will not be an exact result. The proof that this statement is correct is shown by the fact that pollsters always disagree on the exam number. For instance, in this graph on Wikipedia, at the same time, a pollster predicted 48%, while another 54% for the candidate blue. And of course, they cannot be both right, as the real approval rate across the entire country is unique at a given time. Second, what about the average of polls, like the one shown in Wikipedia? Well, while the average helps to mitigate the biases by taking the average of polls producing very different results, this works based on a hidden and fundamental assumption. The assumption that biases are spread according to a normal distribution. A normal distribution, also called a Gaussian distribution, has the property that if we average out the quantity over an infinite number of repetitions, then the average will completely cancel out the noise and we will recover the true value. However, the 2016 US presidential elections and the Brexit referendum showed us that the biases are not normally distributed. This happens, for instance, if all pollsters underestimate the social desirability bias or if all pollsters overestimate the turnout of a certain segment of the population. So while averages, which are also called the polls of polls sometimes, are more informative than a single poll, they may still completely miss the mark for this very reason that biases may not be normally distributed. The third observation regards the way opinion polls results are reported in the media. News outlets always report in their headline only the poll result, without indicating that the pollsters provided a confidence interval. In a way, a news outlet telling us that a poll estimated an approval for a candidate or option of 49% is omitting that the actual result of the poll is instead a range. Because obviously pollsters know that they are affected by biases and they provide a confidence interval to counteract this problem. But telling the public that an opinion poll estimates that a candidate will get between 47 and 52% does not make a clickable headline. So in conclusion, the result of all this analysis is that when opinion polls are relatively close to 50% by even 2, 3, 4%, the real information that we should get is that in that specific circumstances, the opinion polls cannot really predict the result of the election. And the only thing you can do is to go out and vote. Thank you for watching and see you next time.